MedCram.
Well, welcome to another MedCram lecture. We're going to talk about aortic regurgitation. We're going to talk about the causes, the pathophysiology, clinical features, physical diagnosis, treatment, and when we should do surgery. So specifically, we're talking about the aortic valve. And what regurgitation simply means is that the valve is incompetent and we get backflow. And what are the causes of that and what do we do about it? Now, in terms of causes, you can kind of break it down into those less than 50 and those greater than 50. Those less than 50 that have aortic insufficiency are usually due to post-inflammatory. Those after the age of 50 have usually to do with aortic root dilatation. And so specifically post-inflammatory, the type of things that you want to think about are rheumatic heart disease, or RHD. Rheumatic heart disease, infectious endocarditis, think about syphilis. And then in terms of aortic root dilatation, think about other things. Think about age-related. Or the other one to think about is Marfans. Marfan syndrome, as you may know, is where they're very tall, they've got long legs and long arms, and they can get aortic root dilatation. In terms of other things to think about is think about lupus, or SLE, and this thing called ankylosing spondylitis. Ankylosing spondylitis, that's where they get the bamboo spine. Okay, so the pathophysiology of this is that this valve, the aortic valve, becomes leaky and blood goes back into the left ventricle. And this occurs, of course, during diastole. So it's diastolic. That means between S2 and then at the beginning of S1 again. As a result of that, it's going to cause the left ventricle to become bigger because blood is coming back in. It's going to increase the preload. And as a result of the fact that it's pumping more blood, you're also going to get hypertrophy. So you see, it's in diastole. You're going to get a murmur, diastolic murmur. Okay. That diastolic murmur, because it's on the left side, anything that increases the left side is going to cause the diastolic murmur to get bigger. So what are those things that causes the left side to get bigger? Would be any kind of straining. Okay. Anything that increases afterload. And what's going to cause it to get smaller, the murmur to get smaller? Well, anything that decreases the left side of the heart. So that would be a Valsalva. Or anything that causes dilation of the peripheral vasculature, that would be like amyl nitrate. Now, as you may recall, this aorta kind of works as what the German word is, like a Windkessel. Basically, it expands during systole, and then as diastole occurs, it contracts. As it contracts, it kind of ends up like being a pump by itself, pumping the blood forward. However, in aortic regurgitation, instead of that blood going forward, the blood goes backwards, and backwards here into the left ventricle. So you're going to get left ventricular hypertrophy, and you're going to get an increase in the left ventricular and diastolic volume. Now, in addition to that, because during diastole, you've got all this blood coming back into the left ventricle, you're going to see a low diastolic blood pressure. And because there's more blood in the left ventricle right before systole, more blood is going to be ejected out. And so therefore, you're going to see an increase in systolic blood pressure. This is known as an increase in the pulse pressure, which sets up some pretty interesting physical exam findings. So in other words, when you take the blood pressure and you take the systolic over the diastolic, you're going to see that the difference between those two pressures is going to go up. So let's quickly talk about some of the clinical features that you might see. As we mentioned, you're going to see LVH, left ventricular hypertrophy, or a left ventricular end diastolic volume, which is increased. The other thing that you might see is syncope, just like we saw in aortic stenosis. However, there's a couple of reasons why you might see that here. The first is that if the diastolic pressure is so low that you can't maintain an adequate perfusion, you're going to see syncope. But the other thing that you're going to see here, and this is a little bit more subtle, is you might see angina. Now, why is that? The thing you should know is that the coronaries come off of this area in the aorta, and what drives blood pressure, or what drives perfusion in these very important coronary arteries, is actually the diastolic blood pressure. Okay, because flow occurs mainly through the time period of diastole. And so during diastole is when you're going to get this pressure here pushing blood through the arteries to the myocardium. If your diastolic blood pressure is low because it's, instead of going into the coronaries, it's going back here into the left ventricle, you're going to get a decreased coronary artery perfusion pressure, and as a result, you're going to get angina. Now, one thing I will say is that when you look at systole through the cardiac cycle from one period to the next period, let's say we start at S1. S2 is fairly short after it. And then you've got diastole. So this is systole, and this is diastole, okay? Now, where is this regurgitant flow occurring? It's occurring between S2 and the next S1, which is diastole. Something that you may not know is that when you speed up the heart rate, this period of time between S1 and S2 doesn't really change much. It stays the same. What does change is the time period of diastole. It gets shorter and shorter to allow for a faster heart rate. The point is that as the heart rate speeds up, diastole becomes shorter and shorter, and therefore the time for regurgitation becomes less and less. So as a result of this, you usually see that tachycardia is well tolerated. Okay? So tachycardia is well tolerated in aortic insufficiency. Okay, let's talk about physical diagnosis. What you'll see is because this is getting larger, you'll see the apical impulse is going to be displaced downward and to the left. And then the actual diastolic murmur is going to be a high-pitched murmur heard at the left sternal border, and it's going to actually be heard quite well if you have the patient lean forward. So if they're sitting on a table, have them lean forward and then place the stethoscope there. That'll bring that murmur closer to the chest wall, and you'll be able to hear it much better. Now, an interesting thing that occurs is something called the Austin-Flint murmur. It's actually one guy, just with two different names. Austin Flint is the murmur that occurs when blood goes back across the aortic valve, and because it's flowing in here, it tends to keep this mitral valve closed, or at least almost closed. Now, remember that blood is supposed to be going from the left atrium into the left ventricle during diastole, and if this blood from the aorta is coming in and closing that valve, or at least trying to attempt to close that valve, you're going to get a functional aorta or mitral stenosis. That is the murmur of the Austin Flint, and that's a rumbling. Okay, that's a rumbling sound. So you might hear a high-pitched murmur and then a rumbling throughout diastole. That could be an Austin Flint murmur that's associated with an aortic regurgitation murmur. That's from the vibrations. Now, we talked before about this increased pulse pressure, so that the systolic blood pressure is high and the diastolic is low. That causes a change or a pulse pressure that's going to make the pulse pressure go up from our equation. As a result of this, you'll see that people's pulses are very bounding and they're very large in amplitude. And there's a number of things that are found on physical exam. You may want to know some of the names, but they're not essential. So this is known as a Corrigor pulse. Okay, if you've listened to this or if you feel this in the femoral area, it's known as a pistol shot. Okay, that's the femoral. If you hear a diastolic bruit over the femoral area, so a diastolic bruit, that's known as the Rosier sign, D-U-R-O-Z-I-E-Z, the Rosier sign. Okay, now if you see a bobbing head, that's known as the Musset sign, D-E space, M-U-S-S-E-T. And interesting, they used to think that Abraham Lincoln had Marfan's disease because they felt, number one, he was very tall, and also that whenever they looked at pictures of him, they found that his head was kind of a blur, and they needed to take long exposures back in those days, and because of this de Musset sign that he must have had from aortic regurgitation, that they felt that this was proof that he had Marfan's disease. Well, I think the jury was out on that. They don't really know if he did or not, or maybe the photographer was just a bit too shaky. Anyhow, just a little way to put all that together. Another thing is Quincke's pulse. Quincke's pulse is when you look at the nail bed of your fingers and you see that there's a blushing and blanching. So these are all signs of aortic insufficiency. Of course, you're going to order an echocardiogram to make the final diagnosis on that. But interesting nonetheless. So again, how are you going to make the diagnosis? In today's day and age, it's going to be echocardiogram. They're going to be able to look at the valve. They'll be able to tell you how much regurgitation there is. And some other things that might lead you to think is a chest x-ray. What are you going to see on a chest x-ray? Well, if it's severe, you'll see this left ventricle enlarged. You will also see pulmonary vascular congestion, possibly. Obviously, a cardiologist before surgery is going to do cath, where they actually float in a catheter into this area. They can release contrast, and they can see how much is going back and forth. And they can actually calculate the regurgitant volume. In terms of treatment, you're going to want to make sure most of the blood is going out. So the way you do that is with loop diuretics to get rid of some of this excess fluid. And then you want to reduce afterload. And that would be with something like nitrates or hydralazine. You don't want to use things like beta blockers that slow the heart rate down, because remember, if you slow the heart rate down, it's going to increase the time in diastole. This is going to increase regurgitation, and it may steal away some of your perfusion from your coronary arteries. You might actually see a reversal of flow in the coronaries if the regurgitation is that bad. Then your patients will start having angina. Okay, so surgery. When do you do surgery? Basically, when you start to see left ventricular decompensation. So when you see the ejection fraction going down, when you see more congestive heart failure, it's really a cardiologist's call, but that's when you get referral. And of course, you're going to get an aortic valve replacement. You can either get a bioprosthetic valve, which does not require anticoagulation, or you'll get a mechanical valve, which does require anticoagulation. Thank you for joining us.